Discovering Alabama is a production of the Alabama Museum of Natural History.
This is a gastropod. In appearance, it's similar to the seashells that are a favorite attraction for beachcombers. In fact, its design, one of nature's most efficient engineering feats, has been retained by several present-day marine creatures. But this seashell, far from being present-day, is at least 40 million years old. And it holds another surprise.
You might think you'd find the remains of ancient sea creatures somewhere near the sea, but we found our gastropod on a hillside location not far from Troy, Alabama, well over 100 miles from the sea. And that's just one bit of intriguing information of things yet to come as we discover Alabama.
This program is about a land unknown to many people. A land that in many ways has escaped the hustle and bustle of modern civilization. A place with bountiful backcountry, forests, streams, and wildlife more diverse than can be found in much of the inhabited world. Come along with me as we explore the natural wonders of this land. Come along as we discover Alabama. A long time ago in the history of our planet, much of the region that today is the eastern United States was covered with the waters of a vast, shallow sea. Most geologists say those waters were present in varying phases between 300 and 600 million years ago, during the Cambrian and Precambrian periods of geologic time. At about 300 million years ago, the eastern United States experienced a major geological event known as the Appalachian Revolution. This event gave rise to the Appalachian Mountains and literally changed the face of the earth. Eventually, the seawaters receded, uncovering large land areas, including the area we know today as Alabama. With geological change continuing to occur, it's believed that the seas returned again to cover most of Alabama around 70 million years ago, finally retreating to their present position only within the last 1 to 2 million years.
Hi, I'm Doug Phillips. Welcome to Discovering Alabama. The geological history of our state gives us the beautiful mountains in the north and the lovely beaches in the extreme south, two parts of Alabama that are popular both to live in and for recreational purposes. Today, we'll be exploring a stretch of the state between the highland country and the beaches, a part of Alabama that maybe doesn't get as much attention as other regions. Today, we'll be exploring the natural diversity of Southeast Alabama.
Southeast Alabama lies in the major geological region called the East Gulf Coastal Plain. As the name implies, the coastal plain includes that area of the state immersed by the last period of seawaters during their slow recession to the Gulf of Mexico. Located between the more mountainous sections of North Alabama and the sand country of the Florida Panhandle, Southeast Alabama is a transition zone. The topography of Southeast Alabama is primarily rolling hills, with vistas sometimes stretching from horizon to horizon, distinct ridges that often run across several counties, and numerous remote stream systems that almost seem transported from the tropics. Within this general mix of geomorphic character are a delightful variety of more specific land types, as we shall soon see. We begin our journey south of Montgomery in Pike County, near the city of Troy.
It was on an exposed slope like this that we found the gastropod. Being the remains of an ancient sea creature, it's evidence of the sedimentary or water-covered history of the area. It's also an interesting feature that gives us an indication of things to come as we take a wide swing down and across Southeast Alabama.
Downtown Troy, Alabama, is atop one of many hills that compose a broad geological zone known as the Southern Red Hills, so named for their characteristic red soils. An interesting thing about Troy's particular hilltop is that it also connects to a distinct ridgeline of hills, known as the Chinnanoogie Ridge. This ridge formation serves as a divide for much of the drainage basin of the Alabama River on its northern side and the Conecuh and Pea Rivers to the south. Just outside of Troy, there's a feature that's very uncommon for this far inland in Alabama. The term for this feature is pocosin, P-O-C-O-S-I-N, an Indian word meaning a poorly drained, boggy area, usually marked by broadleaf evergreens and soils of sandy humus or peat. The Troy pocosin is further characterized by a large perimeter of sand-covered uplands containing a variety of lichens and scrub oaks. Threatened species such as the Arkansas oak and the Warrior sessifolia depend on the pocosin as essential habitat for their continued existence. Many years ago, the Troy pocosin was a remarkable example of this kind of land formation. Unfortunately, much of it has been altered by timber cutting activity and encroaching development. The remaining undamaged portion awaits protective action before it meets with the same demise. South of the Pocosin and near the town of Brundage, there's a quite unique bit of evidence about the natural history of southeast Alabama. It lies on the property of Horace II, who tells how he bumped into the unexpected one day while working his farm.
I was just back there bulldozing, cleaning up the pasture, and late one evening, it was right at night. I was just pushing down in a ravine place, and I hit the thing with a dozer, and it wouldn't pick it, push it up. So I backed up, picked the blade up a little, gave it a little more gas, changed gear, and went down there and knocked a piece off the top of it, and I seen then it wasn't wood.
It wasn't regular wood anyway, but is believed to be a large section of petrified wood, something that is practically non-existent elsewhere in Alabama. A piece of this unique find is now on display at the Pike Pioneer Museum. The museum also provides an interesting look into the cultural past of southeast Alabama. From Pike County in the Southern Red Hills, we head south toward Dothan and into a geological region known as the Doherty Plain. As the name implies, the land here is characterized by sizable stretches of flat to mildly rolling plains with soils suited for growing peanuts. And peanut farming is what this area is known for throughout the nation. Another important plant that grows here is less known nationally, but sure carries plenty of significance locally. Wiregrass is a native plant whose dominant Alabama range exists only within the 9 or 10 counties of the southeastern corner of the state. These counties refer to themselves officially as the Wiregrass region and take every opportunity to show their pride in this fact. Historically, wiregrass was found throughout this part of southeast Alabama, growing in association with certain natural pine stands. Today, conversion of the land away from these natural conditions has reduced the presence of wiregrass to a relatively few sites. A number of sites that remain are in bog areas, which also provide suitable habitat for pitcher plants, a variety of insect-eating plant that, like the wiregrass, has suffered greatly from prevalent land practices. The parrot pitcher plant adds an element of beauty to a patch of wiregrass, and both require the continued concern of caring landowners. Fortunately, conservation-minded landowners, such as the James Hughes family, recognize the importance of maintaining natural diversity and are taking steps to protect the native species. In a part of the state that's basically sandy, rolling countryside, there are some kinds of natural features that you just don't expect to find. However, Dr. Howard Klontz, a natural resource specialist from Auburn University, recently located one such feature that's a surprise even to some local folk.
This is a good example of the total diversity that's here in southeast Alabama. As part of the Natural Diversity Program for the Department of Conservation, we have begun to examine these sites in southeast Alabama And this is a good example of the diversity. A 30-foot waterfall in a coastal plain is unique. It's different. And it's a special part of Alabama that most people don't really know. We call this place Hidden Falls because of that, the fact that it's so different from what you see all around us.
Beyond its beauty and its uniqueness to this area, Hidden Falls has still greater significance because it tells us stories about the history of this land.
The material here is basically a sandy clay material. And so this whole little pocket here was eroded away over time as the water worked its way through this soft clay. We find the limestone deposits that were laid down some years ago. And above that, we find the sedimentary deposits when this area was covered by an ocean. There's a lot of marine fossil materials in this sediment material. I found a number of shark's teeth. We found coral pieces. We found all sorts of little shells of the marine life that were here. And then on top of that, we can find a little cap of shirt-type material. And then above that, the Southern Red Hills sand. So we get a real clear example here of the gradual development of the coastal plain of Alabama in this particular site.
Much of the natural appeal of Hidden Falls is due to the fact that it is hidden from the beaten path. As one of the last undeveloped waterfalls of the region, it demands that we resist any plan to exploit it. It demands that we respect the integrity of such things in nature that yet remain wild and natural. Heading westward across the lower reaches of southeast Alabama, we move into the heart of the physiographic region known as the Southern Pine Hills, kind of a sparsely populated, remote part of the state. We find in this region, for example, the Conecuh National Forest, a nice place to recreate. If you hunt around in the Conecuh, you might find a couple of natural ponds. They're good places to fish or to camp out. And if you aren't careful, you're liable to wake up one morning by your campsite and find the old alligator swimming right by you. We may not always think about it, but large, remote, undeveloped stretches like this are important ecologically. If we take care of them, they help maintain such critical functions as species diversity. They help to recharge the groundwater, and they even assist in taking out nutrients and recycling nutrients for the whole global ecosystem. And these are important functions to help maintain life in general. One nice thing about vast, remote areas like this is that one can still experience a sense of adventure when exploring the backcountry, like the experience we had in search of a very special cave. After a lengthy trek through the woods, following only a rough guess about the cave's precise location, we almost passed right over a small opening in the ground that looked like nothing more than an oddly shaped groundhog burrow. But when we peered inside, we could see below us the floor of a large underground cavern. A quick search soon yielded a second opening that allowed better visibility. This cave is now legally protected from human encroachment because it's one of the few undisturbed sites for the endangered gray bat, which takes up residence here during its annual migration south. Caves and cavernous outcroppings such as this in southeast Alabama are the result of geological conditions that include underlying limestone strata in some areas. One interesting result of the geology of southeast Alabama is the prevalence of sinkholes throughout the region. This particular location is a sinkhole. It's known as Blue Pond. It's on the Solon-Dixon Forestry Center property, and the interesting thing about Blue Pond is that the water gets up to a certain level, and it may stay that way for months, and then, perhaps overnight, the entire contents disappear. The water just flushes out the bottom of Blue Pond, and nobody seems to understand exactly where the water goes. It all just disappears into some mysterious underground world.
It's
Speaking of strange subterranean places, part of the belief system of many of the tribes of early Indians that inhabited Alabama was that there really is an underworld. To the Indians, this underworld was a place of change, of chaos, disorder. And they associated with this underworld many creatures that to us maybe are creepy crawly, things like frogs and lizards. And one critter that they associated with the underworld is probably especially creepy crawly to us, and that was the snake.
The Indians in South Alabama held great awe for a snake-like spirit they called Ukutana. According to early accounts, this spirit lived in dense thickets, was large and fearsome, and had eyes that could project piercing rays of light. Best evidence suggests that this spiritual myth developed around the large rattlesnakes that inhabit much of the lower coastal plain region. A most common species is the timber rattler, which in South Alabama is often called the canebrake rattler because of its frequent presence, just as the Indians observed, in dense thickets of cane. In fact, cane thickets were so prevalent in earlier times that the Indians often applied the name Conecuh, which means canebrake region. Today, of course, the name is still used, as in the case of the Conecuh River and Conecuh County.
The Indians really gave us more than just place names. We got things from them such as some of our foods, corn, beans, squash, succotash, cornbread, some of our earlier medicines like snake root, poke root, and even some medicines that we still use today. The key ingredient in aspirin, for example, that comes from the willow bark, one of the popular medicines of the early Indians. There are a lot of connections between their culture and ours. We even share a common blood lineage in some cases. In some people, the Indians are their ancestors. So it's important to consider what's common between their belief systems and ours. The Indians, for example, believe that the universe was an orderly place with purpose. We share that. They believe that everything in nature functions in balance, and that the role of the human being is to help maintain that balance between human beings, plants, and animals. But I'm not sure that that's part of the belief system that we maintain today in common with the Indians.
Because of human practices that conflict with the balance of nature, this fella, despite all his armor, may be fighting a losing battle for his survival. Biologist Dr. Robert Mount of Auburn University introduces us to the native gopher tortoise and explains why he's one of several endangered species in the area.
They have front toenails that are flattened for digging. They have elephantine hind limbs, and they're completely terrestrial. The only other kind of turtle that we have in Alabama that you find almost altogether on land is a common box turtle that you see around, and he's able to shut his shell all the way up and doesn't get near that large. And this is the baby gopher. And you can see that he's doesn't look at all like the adult. He's colored like this, presumably to kind of camouflage him against the surface of the sandy soil that they live on when he's out prowling around. Now, he doesn't have any protection. He's got a lot of natural enemies. The adult gopher has no natural enemies, as far as we know at present time. And of course, man is his primary enemy. The gopher has about 40 animals that are associated with its burrows. Among the animals that has taken up with the gopher and spends a lot of his time in gopher holes, especially during the winter, unfortunately, I guess, for the gopher, is the diamondback rattlesnake. The traditional method of hunting the rattlesnakes is to find a gopher burrow that someone thinks might have a rattlesnake in it, and put a hose down to the bottom of it, and pour in some gasoline or blow in some gasoline fumes, and then step back and see if they can get a rattlesnake out. Well, they may not be able to get, or they may be able to, they may not be able to, but by introducing gasoline into gopher burrows, they obviously do a tremendous amount of damage to the gopher tortoise ecosystem.
While some aspects of nature in this part of the state are threatened, others remain abundant. We encountered one example before leaving Covington County.
This is Blue Springs. It generates several hundred gallons of water per minute, and it's an example of one of the richer aspects of Southeast Alabama, and that's the wonderful system of spring waters that can be found in this part of the state. When the famous naturalist William Bartram traveled through Southeast Alabama back in 1777, he found not only abundant spring waters, but he wrote about expansive grassy prairies and grand high forests with giant hardwoods, magnolias, dogwoods that extended sometimes an area of up to 10 miles in distance. But probably the greatest aspect of natural diversity about Southeast Alabama is its rich stream systems. Of course, the character of Southeast Alabama is not the same as it was back in William Bartram's time. The natural diversity has been impacted extensively from human activity. People have to live, they have to eat, they have to work, and that's going to have an impact on the natural surroundings. Southeast Alabama has been hit especially by expansive farming practices, intensive timbering practices. An awful lot of soil erosion has occurred in the southeastern part of the state, and a lot of siltation in the stream systems. Still, it's a remarkably special part of Alabama. Its rural character is still intact, and the natural diversity that does remain is something that's of special concern to a number of leaders in the area.
Foremost among leaders on behalf of the natural qualities of Southeast Alabama is Troy State University, the major college in the area. Under the direction of President Ralph Adams, Troy State has initiated several programs to study and help protect the environment, including the recent establishment of the Center for Environmental Research and Service. For preservation and education, the university has also just dedicated an arboretum. It was the brainchild of biologist Dr. Wayne Adams.
Most people aren't aware of how much we have in South Alabama. We have Alabama is obviously a very, very diverse state, and Southeast Alabama has its own particular properties. We certainly like for this to be a nice looking place and attract people that like to see flowers and trees and shrubs, but at the same time, our main thrust is not only to make a teaching area where we don't have to travel 200 miles or so to point out something that you don't have locally. We can not only use this for the university level, but at all levels of education and to the general public.
I spent my entire life here in Southeast Alabama, and we've got a real natural beauty to be proud of.
There are also concerns from the political community. State Representative Jimmy Holly is a native of Coffee County. As we surveyed the late afternoon view from his home, he shared some of his thoughts.
Other people in this nation have lost the use of the land, the use of the water, and the use of the air. And we don't have to settle for that in Southeast Alabama, or indeed in Alabama. of the southern part of the United States. We can live here, produce our products, and raise our families, and enjoy the land, and still maintain a good environmental policy where the fish and the wildlife and trees also can grow and exist with us, which they must if we're going to be able to stay on this planet.
Southeast Alabama, as we said before, is all too often just a part of the state that people pass through. Our overview of Southeast Alabama is intended to show that even though there are no lofty mountains or ocean beaches, this part of our state is quite rich in natural diversity. Increased education and awareness about the natural environment are critically needed if we hope to live in productive harmony with nature. So next time you think about the importance of maintaining the great natural quality of our state, don't forget about the special attributes of Southeast Alabama. Well, that concludes our trip to sample the natural wonders of Southeast Alabama. We hope you've enjoyed the show, and we'd like to hear from you. And until we meet again, remember, take pride in Alabama's natural qualities.
This production was funded in part by the Center for Environmental Research and Service at Troy State University.